Okay, morning everyone. Sorry about the technical difficulties. We have a really great session ahead of us. I'm just checking to see if everybody here can hear me and is ready to go. So good morning to everyone. We have a few people on video conference already waiting patiently and also on the webinar. Thank you for joining us. I'm really excited to introduce Evelyn Harney. We were able to connect with her with the National Aboriginal Council of Midwives. Evelyn Harney is Anishinaabe. She is a registered midwife in Ontario. She's actually fourth generation midwife in her family, which is really special. She's now currently working in BC in the Okanagan area. She comes from a lineage of midwives on both sides of her family. Evelyn is one of four working midwives in her extended family also, so she has four others, the sacred fours it sounds like. And she's attended Ryerson University. She also has a degree in health studies from McMaster University. And she's going to talk today about how midwives play an essential role in the care of women and their families in Canada, and hopefully share with us why there's very few Aboriginal communities that have access to midwives right now and what we can do about that. So Evelyn, if you wanted to tell us a little bit about, maybe just a little bit more about yourself and what you're going to talk about today, and we can start the PowerPoint whenever you're ready.
Great, thanks Lena. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah. I can hear you okay. We need to adjust the microphone on my desk. Is that it?
Hi everyone.
Hey.
I'm so excited. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, I can hear you fine. You're great. It's me that people are having issues hearing. So
okay.
And it's good now, apparently, to go. So I forgot to introduce myself, Evelyn, so I'm going to back up for a second. My name is Lena Minathy. My mother's Gihahla. I'm Gispid Wada. She's from Kikatla area, which is Dolphin Island, up in the northwest, near Alaska. I'm from the House of Watali. I also have a couple other people helping me today in the room that you can't see, but are off camera, but are really big helps. Davina Ridley is here also. Who's Niska and raised in Kikatla, and Catherine Berry is here as well, who is the Education and Program Coordinator for the program. And we have Stephen Prevost, who is amazingly helping us do tech while he's traveling around BC, helping people put the infrastructure in for these video conferences. So I'll pass it to you now, if you wanna start now, Evelyn, and tell us what you're gonna be doing today and talking about.
Yeah, thanks for the thorough introduction. I don't feel like I have much else to say about myself. My name is Evelyn, and I come from, my family is from Nipissing First Nation on my father's side, and I'll acknowledge also my mother's side, who are French Canadian. I'm from Ontario, but I actually live and work in the Okanagan Valley in BC now as a registered midwife. I did my training at Ryerson, and I did a degree in health studies at MAC, at McMaster, previous to that. And I'm really excited to be doing this today, and I can see some people from their different locations, so that's really neat, too. Do we know who all is on the conference, or how many we have?
Yeah, I like to keep track of who's on the video conference, and let people know that they could ask questions and answer while we're going through. Is anybody on video conference want to introduce themselves and say hello, please? And let Evelyn know where you're at. And I see Adam's like, hello.
Faye Michelle from Hoyston.
Okay.
Hello.
Hello, Michelle.
Hello.
Hello.
I happen to know of a few people who are online as well, so that's really cool. So today I wanted to just talk to you a little bit about being a midwife and what that is, and it sounds like, we'll talk a little bit about what it takes to become a midwife and what the training is, but also what the role of a midwife can be in a community and what that can do for our communities in terms of improving the wellness of our communities. So I think that we can go ahead with the slideshow.
Yeah, I can start the slideshow for you. So Evelyn's joining us from Waterloo today, actually, and I'm here in Vancouver, and so I'll be controlling her slideshow, so we might have a little bit of a lag today, but I think it'll be good. So here you are. Can you see that, Evelyn?
Yeah, it's coming up. There we go. So I was examining the idea of bringing birth back, and we always say, well, we're not really bringing it back if we haven't really lost birth, because we've continued to birth over the years. But I was thinking we kind of mean bringing back our sense of control over birth and our sense of owning that process. So I've decided to change the name of my presentation to Back Into Our Hands, so that we're taking control over birthing in our communities and in our families. Next slide, please.
Okay.
Great. So just to get us started, I just want to acknowledge that we're all joining in this conversation from different parts of Turtle Island, and myself, I'm in the territory of the Six Nations of the Grand River, which is in Waterloo, Ontario, which is the place where I grew up. That's a picture actually of Lake Nipissing, looking onto the Nipissing territory there, which is where my family lives. So next slide, please. So this presentation will address who is a midwife, so what does a midwife do and what does that career look like, the role of a midwife and the role in bringing birth back to our communities, how to become a midwife, and we'll go through some kind of fact versus fiction kind of stuff, and we'll have an opportunity to ask lots of questions at that time. And I just want to show some examples of some successful initiatives that were community-based and midwifery-led models of care. And then I also want to make sure that I mention the toolkit that's been made by the National Aboriginal Council of Midwives, which is the group that I'm a part of as a midwife. So next slide, please. Oh, actually, this picture I took while we were out on the land when I was a student. And the midwives in northern Quebec had accepted me as a student for a month, and I got to experience all kinds of really cool things. So that's a picture I took up there during my midwifery training. Next slide, please.
Oh.
Is somebody... Hello, video conference. Somebody might be not on mute right now. Is that walking in your room, Evelyn?
Hello, this is Nikki. Our system wasn't hooked up, so I'm just got it hooked up now, so she's going to mute it.
Okay, you can mute it. Thank you, Nikki. Okay, next slide. Here we are.
So, who is a midwife? So, in terms of what a midwife does, lots of people know that midwives are involved with pregnant women and taking care of pregnant women. So, what we do is we take care of women through their pregnancy, through their birthing, and in the early weeks of their parenting. So for pregnancy, that means that rather than seeing a physician or a doctor, they would be seeing the midwife. So they would have all of their prenatal appointments with us, any lab work or ultrasounds that need to be done are done with the midwives, or they can be ordered by midwives. If there are any special circumstances, the midwife would communicate with a specialist to make sure that that was taken care of. So all of the regular things that you do for your pregnancy, midwives spend lots more time with women, though, and that gives us lots more opportunity to do an education and all of the prenatal learnings that happen when women are preparing to have their baby. And that includes meeting with the family and having an opportunity to discuss just all of the different stages of pregnancy with the family. And be responsive to people's questions. In the birth, we'll be there for the labor. We do the routine monitoring and the routine assessments. We'd be there to catch or to deliver the baby, provided all has gone well up until that point, and then to do the immediate aftercare. And early parenting for 6 weeks will help look after the family. So helping just getting things off in a good way and with breastfeeding if that's their chosen method of baby feeding and making sure that everybody is doing well in those first 6 weeks so that the baby's growing. That the baby's
okay,
growing
next
well.
Slide. Okay.
No, that's the same one. So okay. Education, what we do, so my training at Ryerson was Bachelor of Health Sciences in midwifery. However, there are a number of community-based midwifery training programs throughout Canada. The universities are the more common way of becoming trained as a midwife. Later on in the slideshow, I have a slide particularly about that, so we'll leave that for now.
Could I ask you a quick question, Evelyn?
Sure.
because you took your... Okay, so can you explain maybe how you became a midwife, and is this an appropriate time to ask you how your family, because you come from four generations of midwifery, how maybe the differences between your generation and the past, or is there another point that you kind of talk about that?
Yeah, there is another point, but I'll skip ahead.
Okay. Well, no, you could just explain maybe what you did through your education then, maybe just as yourself.
Yeah, so in... So basically I was going to university already for, I thought I was going to be a social worker, and I didn't know at that time of my own family history, because it wasn't actually four generations of midwives, it's that my lineage is midwives on both sides. So it has it so that it skipped a couple of generations there, and so those people weren't really talking about it. It wasn't active, and midwifery wasn't readily available for those two generations there. So when I was in school, I took an Aboriginal health class and a women's health class and a global health class all in one same semester, and a bunch of things happened in life where I just decided, you know what, I think this is the right path for me, and I think I can do this. And really wanting to be doing the hands-on work rather than hoping and expecting that that work would happen in a good way without me being involved in it. I just decided I needed to be involved in that work. So I applied to the Ryerson program, and when you apply to the university programs, usually they look at your marks, and then you go through an essay writing component, and then you go through an interview component. Sometimes they go directly from the marks to the interview component. Depending on the application procedures, it'll all be very clear to you if you go onto your program website, if you're looking into applying to a program. But that's what I did, and I managed to get in on my first try, and it was a 4-year program to become a midwife. And I did that in Toronto.
Thank you, Evelyn, for explaining that. Thanks.
You're welcome. So... Where are we? So in terms of, so I wanted to touch on the kind of fact versus fiction or myths versus fact stuff early, because everybody always has a lot of questions about what do midwives do, who is a doula, who's a midwife, and things like this. So very commonly I get the question, what's the difference between a doula and a midwife? And the biggest significance or the biggest difference there is that doulas do supportive work. They do the education component ahead of prenatally, and they do that supportive role for the mom, and they do that aftercare for the mom as well. But doulas are not involved in a clinical sense. So they don't do the physical assessments or the clinic appointments. They would be ordering labs, things like that. So the midwife is the one who does that. So we have that supportive role throughout, but we also have that clinical role. So we'll be doing their checking their blood pressure and their belly checks, checking any blood work, or we'll be looking at ultrasound results, things like that. Things that you would expect a doctor to do in a prenatal appointment, those are the things that a midwife would do. Versus a doula maybe being the companion to be there at that appointment it would be the midwife who does the clinical work at that appointment. Likewise, it's the midwife who delivers the baby. Meanwhile, it's the doula who would support the mother through her birthing. And the midwife will be the one to take kind of the assessments and the measurements of the baby's growth and of the aftercare and make sure that if there's any complications that the mom or baby are seen by a specialist and things like that. So we're the primary care provider. We're the first point of access for women in their pregnancy. So if they have their pregnancy care with a midwife and they're having a health problem, they would approach the midwife first and the midwife would kind of manage them from there. They're not the only care provider for pregnant women, because if a pregnant woman was to sprain her ankle, she might prefer to see a physician who can take much better care of her in that way than a midwife could. So that's a doula versus a midwife. Home versus hospital birth. Lots of people say, well, I don't want to have a midwife because I don't want to have a home birth. And my response is, most women with midwives actually birth in the hospital right now. So it's very common to have a midwife in the hospital. It's becoming more common to have a midwife in the home as well. We need to do both. We're trained at both, and that's part of our job to take care of families where they choose and where they feel most comfortable being for their birthing. And we work alongside all of the staff as well. It's in everybody's best interest for everybody to collaborate and work well as a team, so we work hard at being part of that team. And we enjoy it. Personally, I enjoy it quite a lot working with our colleagues. And then I get the question about pain medications. Well, I want to have a midwife, but I think I would want an epidural. I don't think I could do it without an epidural, things like that. Any pain medication that is offered to anybody having a baby is always offered to a woman under the care of a midwife as well, provided that method of pain relief is available in the community where they're working. So if an epidural is available in that community and the midwife works from that hospital, you can access an epidural. Likewise, narcotic pain relief and things like that. It just depends on what's available in that community. But if it's available in that community, it will be available to you if you have a midwife, because the midwife will facilitate that happening. On the flip side of that, if you feel quite strongly about avoiding pain medications, midwives are trained to help you achieve that, provided everything is happening in as expected, that we want mom and baby to be healthy. If things are veering off track and we recommend pain relief, that's a different conversation. But if everything is going really well and mom and baby the birth is happening in a good way, we can support women who are opting to stay away from pain medications as well. And then my last one was about the cost. Lots of people ask, well, what does it cost to have a midwife? I've never heard of this. My doctor had didn't mention it. Well, it's actually free of cost. It's available through your health card. So if you have a health card, you can have a midwife in BC. It's different in different provinces, but for BC in particular, if you have a health card, you can have a midwife. However, if they're available in your community.
Okay.
So I think any questions from that point.
Yeah, if there's anybody out there on the video conference line or the webinar right now, is there any questions about the myth versus facts about midwifery? And if you're online and you're a midwife via webinar or video conference, feel free to type in or just let us know by pressing your speaker. If there's anything that you've heard that's a fact versus fiction point or something that you've heard and you want to know if it's a true point, she can answer kind of what the myths are and what is actually real. So I'll type that question out to everybody on the webinar too. I think we do have a few midwives actually tuning in today on the webinar. Is there anybody from on the video conference that has any questions to ask? Anybody on the webinar that has anything to ask? I see that there's a few people from there's an obstetrics nurse in Sioux Lookout who's online. There's a doula from Penticton who's actually relocating back to her home area of Kamloops, which is pretty near Okanagan where you're at. There's somebody who's in Victoria who's starting a doula program. Okay, so we'll continue on. If there's any questions online, feel free, and then we can get back to it. If you want to go to the next slide, is that where you want to go, Evelyn?
Yeah.
Okay.
So getting back to what life is like as a midwife, I chose this slide because it kind of represents, or this picture, because it,
Davina?
This is an office of someone, or my colleague Darlene Birch in Norway House, which is in Manitoba. This is her office, and this kind of represents all of the different aspects of what a midwife might do in a day. So you can see the props and the posters, the baby and the pelvis, you know, the posters on the wall. Those are things that we would use in teaching. So when families come to us for care, we might spend time talking about the birthing process or about nutrition and pregnancy, things like that. You can see the bed and the monitor and the supplies, which we use for physical assessment. So we'll be checking her blood pressure and the baby's heartbeat, the position of the baby, the growth of the baby, things like that. Mum's wellness, to do the physical assessments. And you can see that there's some comfy seating there as well to do that chatting work that we do, where we sit down and just check in and make sure things are going well for the family. And every day as a midwife is very different, and it's too bad. We had some videos we were going to show as part of this presentation, but they're not working out today. But the photographs that are in the video should really show the different elements of kind of what we do as midwives.
So yeah, and I can provide these videos as links. If people want to go back to the website, I provide links and resources and potentially this PowerPoint. If Evelyn wants to share it, we will put it on. We'll put links up to the site, and we'll also send out an email after with the follow-up resources. And I actually have a few questions here, if you don't mind, if we go back to the questions from the webinar.
Yeah, sure.
Carolyn DeGustini. She was asking, her question is, how long is the midwifery program for an OB-trained nurse? And then some people were actually asking, answering for her. But Evelyn, what is your take on that?
So if you're a trained obstetrics nurse in BC, there is no different process for training that I know of. As far as I know, everybody goes through the same training program at UBC. However, in Ontario, they've developed a way to do that in a shortened way, but I don't have the details of that, so I'm sorry that I can't speak to that specifically. What have people been answering?
Well, Meryl answered, it depends on which midwifery program. UBC program does not have an option to bypass pieces of the program, so the OB nurse in our program has to complete the four-year program like everyone else, and some Ontario programs have the HCP stream. But I'm thinking a good resource to get to that is depending on your province, right? That's determined by your province.
The HCP would be stands for healthcare providers. So if you're a previously trained healthcare provider, you would go through a shortened process because obviously you have acquired lots of skills and lots of experience, and it's more taking on a different role that needs the training. That you would just check. I think it's Ryerson, actually, that you would probably want to check with. I think that's probably the only one right now that has looked at that specifically.
Okay, great. Thank you. So we can continue on with the PowerPoint if you like.
Cool. So I just wanted to give a few examples of what a week or what a series of a few days would look like for me, just because every day is so different. So, you know, lots of people really like the predictability of a 9-to-5 job and Monday to Friday and weekends off. You know, midwifery is just not like that. It just is not. Babies don't wait, and they really come when they need to, and when they're coming, they're coming. So you kind of have to be a bit more flexible in thinking about plans and things like that. So, for example, but also, like, you know, being on call, it's not as much usually as what we anticipate. So when we talk about being on call 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, it doesn't usually mean that you would do that for weeks and weeks and weeks on end. It would mean that you would have some relief from your colleagues usually. So,
what in your experience, how many clients do you usually have in order for you to keep that busy? I mean, 24/7. How many do you usually have so you can have reprieve?
In the standard, more or less across Canada, is about 40 women to be in your care throughout the year. It can be as much as 60 in BC. But you can moderate that as much as you like. If you feel like working a little bit less, then you would accept less women into your care and do it in that way. But you would have, you know, say on average 40, with your time off and all things considered, it's usually times out to be about a birth a week. And then when we get into home birth, we usually have two midwives attending. So you might additionally attend as an assistant to another midwife in the same week. But, you know, sometimes if some midwives are saying, okay, on call 1 week, off call the next week, that means that that load falls all into a more concentrated portion of time. So you're planned one birth per week, which never ends up being that way in the first place, but the idea is to have about a birth a week, ends up being about two and potentially more. So it just really depends on the way that you organize yourself with your colleagues and organize yourself with your own your own capacities and decide. But say, for example, on a Monday, you might have clinic in the morning. You might be called to assist at a birth as the second attendant in the afternoon. And on the way home, you might go and weigh a baby and do a home visit for a mom who's recently had her baby. And you might sleep fine that night, you know, no calls or anything like that. And then maybe Tuesday, you might be out of labor from 6 in the morning all the way until the night, and then go to bed and sleep all night, which is the ideal situation, of course. It doesn't always work that way. And then, you know, Wednesday, there might be nothing at all except a few minor phone calls because you were on call that day, but nobody had a baby and nobody really needed to see you. They just had some, you know, small questions for you. And so that's what you did on that day. And then the next day, you might have meetings all morning because we do a lot of organizing as well. And you might have clinic in the afternoon. And then that clinic day may actually be more early antenatal or more like pap tests and sexual health kind of stuff. And then you might have a couple of home visits on your way home that day as well. So the variety of what we do from day to day is pretty broad. Mm-hmm. So we can go to the next slide.
All right.
So in terms of Aboriginal midwives and Aboriginal midwifery, the perspective on midwifery is maybe a little bit different because we're working from within our communities and we're also conscious of the whole community's well-being. And it's, you know, with the National Aboriginal Council of Midwives, we, you know, generally agree within our group that, you know, working from within the community is important, and also having that role of the midwife so that we're not always just taking care of that mom and baby or that mom and her partner and her baby, but that we're looking at how that baby connects in the community and that mom's networks and her entire extended family and what that birth means to the grandmother, and how, if that family is wanting to learn about the teachings of womanhood and pregnancy and motherhood and things like that, that we're able to help her obtain that knowledge, and restoring that knowledge back to our communities is really important. And I'm going to talk about where that knowledge went and how we're working to bring that back. Because the role of the midwife was a special role, of course. You know, it is a special role, but it's also the knowledge of a midwife. There is a specialized area in terms of birthing and looking after the woman and the baby, but so much of the knowledge that a midwife has is the knowledge that all women used to have. And so part of what we're doing is trying to restore that reproductive knowledge to the community, and so that women don't have to wait and write a list of their questions to bring to us at their next appointment, that they're able to ask their neighbor or their cousin or their sister or their mom in the way that was done before. And that connecting over pregnancy and childbearing is really significant for our communities. So the role of the midwife, so in lots of communities this is still the case, and I guess that's how it used to be. And so what has happened specifically through the process of colonization, there's been a changed role of women, where women have switched from being equals to men to being secondary to men. We know that that has happened over time, and that it was a fairly sudden switch. And that also changes the role of the midwife, because the midwife is usually a woman, and she's caring for women. And for most communities, birth is a very important process that brings a lot of honor to women in general. Women are honored as givers of life and as important just the life-giving process. I mean, belongs to women, but it's also the raising of the children and things like that. And when women are undervalued, all of that becomes less valued as well. So a change in the role to women. A lot of communities I know history is very different in Western Canada. Being from Eastern Canada, I'm still learning about the history in Western Canada, but I know a lot of our communities were, the people with specialized knowledge were directly targeted during when communities were raided in a violent way. They would have looked and found who the midwives were, who the people were who knew the plant medicines and who could take care of people, that those people were targeted. And so that's an immense loss of knowledge just right there in the loss of that person in the community. And in a lot of communities, there were significant relocations that happened. So people who lived in drier areas were moved to more damp areas, and, you know, vice versa. People were relocated to places where their plant knowledge was not applicable anymore. So that lost a lot of the birthing knowledge as well, through the loss of that plant knowledge and the knowledge of where you're living. And then, of course,
Can I interrupt at that point? And you're saying there's a difference from East and West. Did you want to speak to the East at all, since from your knowledge from your territory?
Well, yeah, I guess I'm speaking to what I know of where I come from. So, yeah, that's kind of what's happened here. Yeah, I know, like, colonization happened just much earlier here, so there was a lot more time to do a lot different things, I guess. And then, of course, all across Canada, there is a loss, like the relocation of children, obviously through residential schools and foster care adoption, loss of knowledge transmission, so that, you know, when we have reproductive knowledge through midwifery, we're not passing that down to our children if our children are not in our care, right? Birth itself has been relocated by making midwifery illegal at one point, taking birth out of the communities, which is still the case now in a lot of our communities where people are driving far distances or flying out of their communities to have their babies. We lose that contact with the family in late pregnancy and in birthing and in early parenting, and that's a huge loss of midwifery knowledge and birthing knowledge for the community as well. And that causes, obviously, a disconnect between parents, children, extended family, grandparents, and the community. And just not being able to participate in those activities around birthing and welcoming babies early and things like that. And so really just the whole point here is just to say that the role that Aboriginal midwives are taking on is to try to restore that. That we're not just taking physical care of mom and baby, and that we're looking at the whole bigger picture of where things are at now and how can we work to establish well communities and healthy communities through caring for people in their childbearing years. We know that we have a chance to really access that new life right at the very, very beginning as it's forming in its mother, and also that mother and that family at a really important time in their life. We know that we have the ability to really help people a lot and to help our communities be well. So we can go to the next slide.
Okay, I'm going to interrupt you for one more question. Carolyn DeGhistini said, how important is it, do you see the role in prenatal classes? How important is the role that they play in the success of the birthing process?
Prenatal classes, I think, are really significant right now because we kind of have this system where that knowledge is kept in little silos, kind of. And what we're doing in prenatal education is we're accessing that little silo of birthing knowledge. I do think it has a really good impact on people's experiences because they know what to expect. They go in informed about, you know, what might happen or what might things look like, or, you know, I think it's just really important. How might it feel? What are the things that might take place? What will happen once the baby's been born? Things like that are really significant, and people really need to talk about that before having the baby because it can be really scary for a lot of people. So I do think that prenatal education is really important. I would love to see us get to a time, though, where we don't need it because we have that knowledge as people rather than only during pregnancy. I think probably the best thing about prenatal classes, though, is that connection between the couples and the women who meet each other. I think that that's really important in building a good community, too, where women have those connections. I know for a long time my mom used to hang out with her friend that she had made in her Lamaze class in 1981. And so for many years they kept in touch and were good friends, and I think those are cool relationships you can have at an important time in your life, like when you're pregnant. So I think it's really good, but I also think that there's a role in trying to maybe take some of that information and just make it more normal. Does that answer the question?
I think it's a great question, but Carolyn can tell us later. We can move on to the next slide, which is a beautiful image. Is this your home?
This was my home at one time. This is, I was lucky enough to stay in a vacation home through winter in Penticton. And the quote, or the what's written on the bus, is community in all places at all times with all ages. And I think that's part of what distinguishes Aboriginal midwifery as well, is because you have that role in the community. So you might get stopped at the gas station because somebody's baby is teething and they want to know what they can do for them. Or, you know, they might even just drive by your home sometimes and say, you know, this thing is going on, or I hear, you know, about pregnancy, I have, you know, this thing happening. And it's really, I really enjoy that aspect of being in that role in the community. So this picture is just the view from the backyard there, the beach. And it just represents that, you know, at one time when I was new to the area, I had heard from three different people that there was somebody coming in from out of town to have her baby, and she didn't know where to go because she was not hoping for a hospital birth. She was hoping to be out of the hospital, but she lived too far away for the midwives to go to her. So because I wasn't working at that time, I opened my home to her. And in the end, it sounded like there were three different women with the same problem, excuse me, but it ended up that it was all the same person, and they had a really beautiful birth in that home, and it meant a lot to everybody to have pulled together to help her and that family achieve their desired birth experience. Yeah, so we can go to the next
slide.
That's
a great story. Okay.
So in terms of Aboriginal midwifery, probably the most significant thing is that a lot of our communities don't have access to any care at all, not just midwifery care, but the pregnancy care and birthing care is not there. You might have a nurse who might do prenatal care, and they might be in the community, but at some point, lots and lots and lots of women are leaving the community. And what we're trying to do is to try and have that conversation about what is this doing to the communities to have birth away from family and away from the community. So the first place to start, in my opinion, is just looking at the life cycle. And there are all kinds of different names for this. And one that I know is the hoop of life, that everything is connected. And you can see, you know, you can see like every cycle in our life, you have morning, afternoon, evening, and night. You have spring, summer, fall, and winter. You have birth, growth, aging, and dying. And all of those aspects are important to keep together to give us a full picture of life. And when we start to take pieces of that away, we lose our concept of what life really is, and it can really change our entire worldview. So if you were to take away, you know, the morning, how would the day make sense without the morning? It doesn't make sense. The sun has to rise to be up in the afternoon. It doesn't make sense, right? You know, how do you have summer without springtime? You know, springtime is that beginning of new life. It's an important time. And everybody right now that spring has finally arrived, everyone feels so great because it was a long winter and it was really dreary. And, you know, especially here in Ontario, it was really, really rough winter. And everyone is so happy that it's spring. But imagine if you took that entire part of this cycle of life away. Birthing falls on that side. It falls where the sun rises, where the plants start to grow in the spring. It's on that side. It's that part of our life cycle. So if we took that away, you have an idea then for a second of what the concept of life must be like for communities that have been disconnected from birth for generations now. It's really traumatic, I think, for a lot of communities to only have traumatic loss of life and sudden loss of life, because people who are having advanced medical treatment are being treated in centers, larger centers, away from home as well. So what we would consider a normal death, you know, someone passes away in a way where the family can be there, for most people in our remote communities, they don't have that experience either. And that's a really important aspect of life as well. So we can move to the next slide. So the point of this here, which is an image that I don't like, and I don't like to show it, but it really drives home the point of what is missing when we separate care from our communities and what that really looks like. So some people, you know, the way that the hoop or the wheel is angled and things, it's all kind of different in different places, but this is where I chose to start things. So the beginning of life, let's say that we take that away, the baby's been born away from the community, and they come back and they have their childhood there, but they don't have high school in their community, so they leave for high school, and they might come back, and you know, something might happen, they might need a medical treatment, they might have to go through the justice system away from home. They might have a baby themselves. You know, they might go away several times in their youth and in their young adulthood, away from the community for college or what have you. There are so many reasons to have to leave the community, but you can see that that makes a huge disconnect. And then later in life, maybe they have another baby, or maybe they're away for whatever reason for an extended period of time. And then at the end of life, let's say they have a chronic illness that can only be treated at a larger center, then that's how they pass away, that the beginning of their life and the end of their life were completely away from the place that they call home. And all of the people that can be there to support them, but also for those people to be there to support them, is a really significant part of their lives as well. So this image is just to really show that disconnect that a lot of communities have, a lot of people have throughout their lives, and how that can really impact. You know, it looks like a broken horseshoe shape. It's not a perfect hoop or a wheel anymore. And I think that, you know, for Aboriginal midwives, coming in with this knowledge, knowing that this is where a lot of our communities are coming from, the question we're asking is, what can we do to fix this and make this better and make this whole again and preserve this circle? So we can go to the next slide. So I really love this picture. My first year of midwifery my first year after I graduated, I practiced midwifery in Saskatchewan. And this is the sunrise in Saskatchewan. And I actually took it out of the back of my car as I was driving. But it's just so beautiful. And you can imagine like what life would be like without the sunrise. And bringing birthing back is bringing back that sunrise on our communities. It's so critical and also very beautiful. So next slide, please. I think we're going to show the video here, but we'll move on. Lena, I can see you talking, but I don't know if you're talking to me.
I will put the Aboriginal midwifery on a link on our website and also email out the link so people can see that post-webinar.
Okay. Great. Thank you. Yeah, so the National Aboriginal Council of Midwives, the vision of our group is Aboriginal midwives working in every Aboriginal community. That is the goal. And that will happen. It will just take some time.
There was a question about this, and maybe you can address this. I'll just stick this in before you start this. But when people are wondering if there's actually a database of Aboriginal midwives, and specifically, is there one for the province as well, for BC? And there's a personal question if you want to answer it at some point in your next slide. How do you balance your work day and family? Are there many single parent midwives? If there's any tips upon that. Okay. I'll let you continue now. Okay.
So the first question was about where are these midwives in Canada? So if you go to aboriginalmidwives.ca, that's the NACM, the National Aboriginal Council of Midwives, we go by NACM. That's the NACM website. And it has a map there of where the midwives are across Canada. And it has some biographies there as well to see kind of who is working where. That's probably your best resource right now. In terms of BC, that's something that we're working on. So if you go to bcmidwives.com, that is the address for the Midwives Association of BC, and we're working on developing an entire portion of the website that's devoted to Aboriginal communities and midwives. And so we'll be able to have a map there of who is working where and which communities are evacuated versus which ones have care in their community and things like that. Because I think that kind of information is going to be really good to continue the conversation about how people want it to be versus how it is. And in terms of, was the question about work-life balance?
Yeah, and if there's single parents that can be midwives in the community and how to make that work.
I definitely think that it would be difficult to be a midwife without the support of the people around me. Like, I think that's true for all midwives, and all the single parent midwives that I know personally, I mean, especially in school, they blew my mind all through school. It's a hard thing to even imagine when you're on call and you might not have somebody who you could, you know, leave your children with through the night if you're called out in the night and things like that. Everybody I knew made arrangements and they had really, really supportive networks in place. And it does take time to establish those. But if you're considering midwifery as what you would like to do, then start building those networks now, because you know, it becomes a pretty, you'll need it later, and just for even little logistical things. But for myself, like, I've tried working as a full-time midwife, but it's just not for me. Like, I just don't, it doesn't jive with me. Like, I need time. I do a lot of committee work. I do a lot of community activities, and I don't, it's hard to be full-time. So for me, my strategy has been to scale back my hours. And I think that's been the strategy for a lot of midwives. And for lots of midwives, they're just super motivated and excited, and they just want to work all the time, and it's what they love. And, you know, if that's you, then awesome, you know. But everybody has their own process that they go through to determine, okay, what's my limit? And we're lucky that midwifery is well paid enough that we can work less hours and still be able to sustain ourselves. So it's always an option to scale it back a little bit. That's been what I've had to do. I take long periods of time off as well. You know, lots of midwives might take a week or two, but in Ontario, it's very much the standard to take a month off at a time. And that's where I did my training, so that was my expectation going into midwifery, and that's what I do for myself as well. I take like a whole month or maybe 2 months off and see my family and just, you know, I'm just like a regular person who gets their groceries during normal hours and goes to bed and sleeps every night, you know, for weeks on end. It's amazing. But, you know, and then you do that and then you start to wish that you could go back to it. So I never stay away so long that I miss it too much.
Okay.
How's that?
That's a great answer. So let's want to continue with the next the slide, the NACM core values, and then I'll take some questions after this slide too.
Oh, can I just let you know, I can't see the slides at Adams Lake.
Oh.
Okay, Adams Lake, thank you for letting us know. I don't think there's anything we can do because we are playing it over the video conference and webinar right now. Unless you log into the webinar, perhaps in a laptop too. So. Okay.
So, all right. And all of these slides, and for those of you at Adams Lake, we'll make sure that it's available for you after to have a look if you'd like.
Yeah, we can send the slides out.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So, for the NACM core values, this just kind of helps us to explain where we're coming from in our work, and it also just helps to understand what makes midwifery or Aboriginal midwifery distinct. So good health and well-being of Aboriginal mothers and their babies is crucial to the empowerment of Aboriginal families and communities. That's ultimately where we're coming from. So the values then of healing, we know there's a lot of work to be done with our families in knowing that the process of birthing can be healing for families is an important angle to take in our communities. Respect, autonomy, compassion, bonding, and bonding is with the whole community. So not just, you know, having birth in that community helps the whole community to, you know, in a small community, you know when a baby's born, and then everybody has an opportunity to acknowledge that new life and to celebrate it in their own ways. But just knowing that it's there is really significant. And it also, I think that communities become invested in their children when they're around at such a significant time as their birth. And bonding the family, maintaining that bond between mother and child, and helping things to go in a good way for that family. Breastfeeding is an important value for NACM because we know that breast milk is one of our strongest and most precious medicines. And we want to try to support parents with breastfeeding because it's not always easy, but we need to have that conversation about the good that it can bring our communities to increase breastfeeding and how we can do that in a way that is helpful. Cultural safety is just meeting people where they're at. Not everybody wants, you know, traditional knowledge or traditional aspects to their birthing, and lots of people do, and just taking care of people where they're at is just a really important thing that we do. Clinical excellence, you know, a lot of times people say, well, if it's an Aboriginal midwifery training program, which is what we have outside of the universities in other parts of Canada, not yet in BC, but in other parts of Canada, we have education programs that are not through the universities, but we want to communicate that we still strive to be excellent clinicians that work at a high standard of care, that having a university recognition of that is not, you know, considered the absolute be-all and end-all of what makes a good midwife in our communities. And we promote education for the family, for the community, for ourselves, and a sense of responsibility to uphold the role of the midwife and to make sure that we're responsive to our communities. So we can move to the next slide.
I have a question at the end of this slide. It's a harder question. I have a couple comments saying that one person said they liked the statement, taking care of people where they're at. And then Ryan said it's the purest expression of self-determination, in his opinion. And I have a question from Kim Rowan, which is a little more in-depth. How will midwifery approach in the northern communities that are so plagued with drug addiction and babies are born with mothers who are abusing substances or involved with TAPER programs? Will midwifery have the support and resources in the community to help moms facing drug addictions and the birthing their babies in the community safely? That's kind of a really big topic to take on, drug addictions. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I think the more support families have and women have, the better. Like, I can't see the harm in that. Certainly, like, every community has to decide what they need from their midwives and what they need from care providers in general. The communities have to be the ones to lead the way, because you can't come into a community and say, this is how we're going to do it, if that maybe isn't the way that the community feels they need to be looked after, right? And, you know, coming from within communities, a lot of times you can get a sense of what's needed, but it's still really important to have that discussion over what's needed. Definitely expanding our skill set is a necessary, usually, component of being a midwife in any rural or remote setting, because we'll come into contact with lots of situations that midwives in other settings may not ever. And that includes helping and counseling families who are struggling with addictions. In terms of birthing, like, it's all just depends, right? Like, if we're looking at a situation where we're not expecting a healthy mom and baby, and we're not in a place where we can provide advanced care or help them to have access for that, then, you know, we wouldn't be there necessarily. We would have to support them to have that kind of care elsewhere. But if we're close to a center where that kind of care is available, we can be there to accompany them through that. Or if pregnancy-wise everything is looking still healthy, there's no reason why the midwife wouldn't still be the care provider. It just really depends on the situation. Like, it's hard to say it would always be like this, because every family and every person in our care is just so unique with their own needs and with what they want out of their birth and experience, right? Not all, you know, mothers parent their babies after they're born, and that's something that we're very aware of as well. So, you know, every family, we try to just be really individual, you know, in approaching, just because no two people are alike. I wouldn't expect any two pregnancies to be alike either, or any two families to be alike or anything like that. But in terms of drug addictions and things like that, yes, it's an issue, and we would just have to address it with that community specifically. Yeah. And then what were the other two comments, Lena? I think you're on mute.
The self-determination comment came from Ryan. He was saying that it's the purest expression of self-determination, is bringing back birthing to the community. And also, Carolyn said that she liked your statement of taking care of people where they're at. And that kind of goes into the drug addiction answer too, depending on where that mom is at, depending on who she is and what substance and what's happening in her life at that moment. And if she's getting other care, then that you'd have to make sure you meet the individual person's situation, right?
Right. And a lot of times what we're doing is we're advocating. We're there with the women. The word midwife means to be with woman, and it's a word that applies to us as well in our work, because, you know, sometimes you just have to be there, and sometimes just being there as an observer and being able to have a discussion afterwards is an important thing too. A lot of times, like, we know that, you know, I heard something yesterday that I know I had heard before, but an elder, her name is Gudgie Cook, she's a midwife. I had the chance to sit with her yesterday, And she said that currently there are more foster children in care than there ever were in residential schools. Mm. And it's, I've heard that before, but the way she said it, again, really kind of got me. And it makes you think, like, gosh, we have to be working for our families. And we have to be working from the very beginning of that life, which is before pregnancy. It's working with families to get them ready for pregnancy and working with women through their coming of age, into their womanhood, into their adulthood. So when it's time to have babies, that preparation is there and that person is healthy and that family is going into that parenting in a good way. And we can't always do that. Sometimes we're meeting people, you know, a week before their due date because they didn't tell anyone they were pregnant or whatever it is, right? Like, we just have to, you know, do what we can. But ultimately, the idea is to build healthy people from the time they're being thought of in through their life, guide those people, you know, those young adults through that into where they're the ones having the babies and helping things to get better and better with each generation. It's not easy and it won't happen quickly, but that's the idea. And yes, absolutely, self-determination. Like, that's how there have been successes in other communities, is other communities have said, I don't want to leave my community to have my baby. I want to stay here, and I need you to find a way to help me do that. And that's happened and been successful in other places. And I'm not saying that that's the right thing to do everywhere, but for some places where the feeling is very strong about that, it's a conversation that needs to happen. Yeah, so we can move on.
And so again, this video will be up and available on the links on the website as well as emailed out to everyone after.
So becoming a midwife, so I have the link there, which goes directly to the midwifery education and training page for in the NACM toolkit. So then you'll be able to figure out kind of what the best pathway is for you for training as a midwife, or if you know somebody who might be interested. We also try to make connections with aspiring midwives. So we have a mentorship program that we kind of started. It's a fairly casual thing right now, but if you're an aspiring midwife, if you're thinking seriously that you want to do this and maybe you want some help with applying or something like that, you can contact NACM and we'll pair you with a midwife nearby to kind of, there are certain ones of us working across Canada. I'm working in BC, and so if you were saying that, then you would be connected with me, and we could make sure that your application requirements are looked after and that anything like that, that whatever we can do to help you get to where you want to be going. In terms of becoming a midwife, or maybe there's another career option that suits you, that's something, you know, around birthing, we might have more information on that as well. Great. And then every university, so let's say you've decided that the community model, you look through your options and you've decided you want to apply to a certain university, or there's always an Aboriginal student service with the university, whether it's called, you know, First Nations Student Services or Aboriginal Student Union or whatever the name is for that particular institution. It seems like they're all different from each university to university. But always start there as well, because they have counselors who will coordinate to help you apply. So at UBC, you would contact, maybe Lena, do you have that information on the academic counselors who help with applications?
I can get some links to provide at the end of the webinar too. There are some people here that can help us with that.
Absolutely. And then, you know, I've already kind of told you a little bit about my road to becoming a midwife, so I don't feel necessarily, unless you have questions about that. I will say, though, that I did want to become a midwife kind of in my third or my second year of a three-year program at McMaster, and I actually had to go back and take a summer class in grade 10 biology to be able to apply to the midwifery, or to be able to get into the scientific prerequisites to get into the midwifery program. So sometimes there's a little bit of backtracking that needs to happen before you can move forward. But definitely looking at this as a serious option, you'll be able to say, okay, well, what courses do I need? And do I need tutoring, or do I need to, you know, find out about upgrading and things like that? But I had to do that myself, even though I was already in university at that time. So I found that really helpful. And in terms of the future of midwifery training, you know, it could go any direction you decide. Like, we think we're always waiting, well, UBC has this and UBC is working on this, but, you know, UBC needs to know what you want, and they need to know where you are. And if you want to train as a midwife and you're located somewhere where you can't necessarily easily access the program, it's really good for people to know that you're wanting to do that, so that in their, when they're rolling out the new programs, you know, there's talk about expanding to the different campuses. But it's really important for them to hear from you about the way you would like to see that done, if you would like online courses and where you would like to be able to do your placements and things like that. It's really critical information for them, because there is only the one program right now in BC. And in terms of developing a community-based midwifery training, I don't think that's impossible, but I do think it would take a lot of conversation about it. So if that's a conversation you feel is important, then get that going and get the ball rolling, because it doesn't happen without your input.
Do you think that there's going to be, there's only UBC available right now, but I have actually a UNBC graduate in the room with me, Jen. Do you think UNBC will ever look at Aboriginal midwifery at this point?
I'm sorry, I missed the question. I'm working.
Sorry. You are from UNBC. Yeah. Do you think that there's an interest in Northern British Columbia ever having midwifery? Or do you think that there's been any comments or talks on that?
I'm not sure at this point. I know that midwifery here at UBC is within the Faculty of Medicine. It's a small faculty.
Yeah.
But it's a possibility. I know that it would be a good thing to have those conversations, especially in the north, where access to services is a little bit more of a challenge compared to lower mainland. I think that would be something worth discussing in the future.
Okay. Yeah, so if we can, thank you, Jen, and we can put up the links later to the UBC midwifery site as well. I don't have the link in front of me right now, but...
It's going to be something to consider that if, you know, I know we're on the UBC Learning Circle right now, but, you know, other universities can consider it too, right? Like, other institutions and groups can consider if that's something that needs to happen, but... I think the more the better, really. So, especially there's so many applicants to the midwifery program, it's insane. It's so crazy, and they only accept 20 per year. And so many of the midwives in training I talk to, they say, oh, I got on my second try. You know, wouldn't it be nice if you had really wanted to do something with your life that you could be able to do that right away? So, you know, I think it takes time to grow any profession. But, you know, let's start having those conversations.
Do you think it's easier out east? I mean, is this something we can, do people want to travel to be able to do this too? It depends on if they can do that at all. But you said that the out east has a different infrastructure.
So 3 universities and the Six Nations Birthing Center have their training programs in Ontario. And enrollment is quite a lot higher than at UBC, because it's more established. It's been there for more years. Like, it's had time to grow. So in some ways it's more accessible, because one of the locations is in Northern Ontario as well. Laurentian University is in Northern Ontario. So there are different ways of accessing it. I think it still needs to be more, though, because they're still turning away a lot of applicants, and it's a profession that needs to grow quickly, because there are so many people who don't want to deliver babies anymore, and so many people who are delivering babies who will be retiring soon. So any profession where people are willing to be in that role is important to be focusing on that, I think, right now. The Calgary Mount Royal University has a program. There's a program in Winnipeg as well. There's a program in Quebec as well. So, you know, and those are all available on that midwifery education page that I've posted, which includes the information for the community-based programs as well. Which I think that, you know, not being from those communities, it would be a little bit more difficult to access. But the point there is that they exist and they're recognized and they do a good job of training midwives, and that it's a conversation worth having if maybe that's something to look at for, you know, in terms of developing midwifery in different ways.
Or there could be some advocacy maybe to the Northern, to Prince George, UNBC, the Northern communities to get these programs up and running. So,
yeah. We can go to the next slide. I just wanted to point out a couple of successes that Aboriginal communities have had in bringing about midwifery. And these are really community-focused and community-led models. It's, you know, a lot of times when we're thinking about the kind of care that we provide in Aboriginal communities, the conversation is a lot about cultural sensitivity and cultural competency and things like that. But what about culture, and what about the community doing this and leading the way? I think that's really critical. So up on the top left is the Inland Civic Health Center logo, which just represents the Nunavik midwives who've been working for over 25 years in their remote communities. They have an air evacuation plan for high-risk situations, and they're quite remote, but when you watch the videos, you'll be able to see clips of that community and see clips of those midwives speaking to what they do and the work that they do. But that was a community-led effort. Those women said, I don't think our community can handle being evacuated anymore. It's causing too many problems in too many different ways. We need to get birth back, and that's what they've done, and they've been successful. Nunavik has three training programs on the Hudson Coast, and then also now a training program in one of the communities that's in the interior of the Nunavik region, which is the Arctic region of, or the northern region of Quebec. So I would say that that's a huge success. It's major, actually. They've been recognized by the World Health Organization. They've been recognized, you know, those midwives who train up there, they train with fellow midwives there, and they're recognized by the university in Quebec. So it's pretty remarkable. And then beside that, I have the logo there for the Six Nations Birthing Center, because they're also an example of a community-based, community-led model of providing midwifery care and education in the community. So I don't know how many years they've been there, but it's lots. It's more than 15, I'm pretty sure. And they do really good work. They're very responsive to the community, and they have a lot of collaborations with people with a lot of knowledge, and they train on site there as well. And then on the bottom left is the logo for the Seventh Generation Midwives Toronto, and that's where I did my practicums as a student, most of them anyways. And that was a practice, it's a registered midwife practice, and they decided that the urban community needed an Aboriginal-focused practice, and so that's what they've developed. And right now, everybody's talking about them because they've been involved in developing the Toronto Birthing Centre, or the Toronto Birth Centre, and so it's an Aboriginal-focused birthing centre downtown Toronto in the inner city, and it's so beautiful. It's really beautiful, and they have elders coming in to speak all the time, and they have babies being born there all the time, and it's really a reason to celebrate. So that's really exciting for the community there. And then the one on the right side is just the building to the Fort Smith Health Center, where in Northwest Territories they've managed to obtain or create a health service that is led by the midwives in their community, and they evacuate to Yellowknife if needed, but lots of babies are born there. So that's a major success. And we know that there are others developing and that have developed over the years, but these are just a couple of examples of what's happened so far. So we can move on to the next one.
Somebody has one more question for you. They asked specifically, were you a parent already while you were in school? And if so, how did the children handle it and adapt?
So no, I wasn't a parent when I was in school. And really, like, that's something to, you know, I think, like, in any training program, I think it's difficult when you're having to share your time with other things, and all parents have to weigh that balance. And, you know, growing up in a home where my mom was in school part-time for many years, I can appreciate the desire to have that attention when mom's busy, but I think it's the same as working as a midwife. It's not, you know, it's a full-time commitment. You do need the support of people around you for childcare and also to provide them that sense of security when you're away at odd hours. But in terms of, like, the actual, it's just, you know, for a year and a half of your program at least, you'll be doing academic work, which is predictable, and then your on-call time would start later. So as much as it looks like it's a four-year on-call kind of commitment, really, actually, it's just more than half, usually, the programs to be doing that on-call work, and you do get designated time off, and those are things that you work out. But the only way to learn is just to kind of jump in and get your support network happening now while you're anticipating that.
Yeah. And there's another comment from Lisa Peterson who said there's not often they have services available in the community, and they're told that there's regulations in Quebec that are different, but she's not too sure. But she said that in general, Indigenous midwifery is very rare in Quebec, if at all. So I don't know how much you know about that province, but yeah, that was just a comment she kind of made. So
yeah, I mean, and it has to be the communities themselves that try, that do that work to having midwifery there. And that's the hard thing when a lot of people have been told midwifery is bad, or, you know, during a time when ceremonies and midwifery were outlawed, and it was not, you know, midwives were told you can't do this anymore or we'll send you to jail. Or, you know, there's been a lot of communities that have developed a sense of we can't do that, we shouldn't do that, it's wrong or it's bad. And it really takes people from within that place to kind of have that discussion and say, well, actually, you know, this might be really beneficial, or this might be really good, or look what they're doing over there, or how can we get something that is similar, or whatever it is. But you're right, it's really rare. And, you know, when you see the map, when you go on the NACM website, like, we're a small group. And I know that there are midwives out there who are not part of NACM, and I know that there are midwives out there who are registered and working who are also not part of NACM, so we can't necessarily represent all of the work that's happening across the continent, but it's true. It's something that we have to build up. It's really sad that we've lost a lot of our traditional midwives already, and that discussion kind of has to start happening if it hasn't already, I think, because, you know, I think it would be good, even if communities still have to evacuate for birth, having that kind of person from the you know, from within that community or that family being part of their process as, you know, building that family, I think is really significant, even in a time when evacuations might still take place. So you're right that it's really rare. It's rare all across Canada. Yeah. Was there another question?
I think that's it. But thank you for your response, Lisa said.
So then I just wanted to show a couple of links, and then Lena's going to post a bunch of links after as well. The toolkit that NACM has developed is geared towards communities looking to restore birthing in some shape or form. And midwifery is seen as, you know, potentially a big part of that. Potentially, you know, it's up to you to have that discussion with the people around you to decide what's best. But this toolkit, it has a bunch of videos and audio clips about training to be a midwife and what it's like and what the job is like, what midwives can do in a community. But, you know, it has all the different provinces and territories, a talk about kind of what the process is for midwives in each different part of Canada, and some activities of how to engage your community to assess really, is this what we want to do, or are we okay with how things are for now? So that toolkit is made specifically with that intention. We had a grant to go across Canada and to engage with communities and to see, and everywhere we went, people said, we want to do this, or I want to do this, or, you know, we had a really good response all across Canada. So I really think that this toolkit will be helpful to get the ball rolling. Wherever you are and wherever it seems appropriate. And then I also wanted to show another video that is on YouTube, and I have the link there, because I think it's just a story of how transformative the birth was of a particular person who really needed that in her life, and I think it's really inspiring. And if you're considering midwifery at all as a profession and coming from it from the perspective of wanting to see people become well, this is a really great example of that.
And so, yeah, I typed it into the webinar, and we'll provide that link after for the video conference people.
Great. And so next slide. So I have questions there, but I want to describe this picture as well. I found this picture, and it's a picture of, obviously a whole bunch of babies and their cradle boards, but it was taken the year before my great-grandmother was born in the region where she's from. And I always imagined maybe this is how she was toted around in her little stuff, and I really love the little one up at the top with the big cheeks. But it's a really neat picture, and there's a, you know, like my great-grandmother, she was taught how to do the work of a midwife, not because she wanted to, but because there was a need for it at that time. And I think that that's part of what we're doing here as well, is just kind of responding to a need. Not that we don't want to, but you know, that we want to, but that need is really there, and people are really asking for that. And according to the United Nations on Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, it's actually a right to be able to transmit traditional knowledge in the way that we decide, or that First Nations and Aboriginal people decide. And so looking at birthing and things like that, I think is really important. So I wanted to just close on that note. Were there any questions at all?
I'm going to put that out to the video conference people. Is there anybody on video conference that has a question to ask Evelyn? And any questions on webinar 2, you can type them in. And let us know who you are, maybe what nation you're from. And we'll take any responses as well, if you have any comments or responses. So, Evelyn, thanks for making time today. I know you're out in Waterloo, and I know you're visiting family there, so I appreciate it. And you're located right now in BC and in the Okanagan. Is there somebody specifically you're working for there?
So I'm working with Maternity Care West Side, which is in West Kelowna. So I work in terms of hospital, Kelowna General Hospital is my current Yeah, but I won't be there until June again. I'm home until June, pretty much. So.
Okay. And how long have you been in Kelowna for now?
I moved there just over 3 years ago. Yeah, I decided to stick around a little longer than I first thought. But it's been really good. I live in Penticton, but I'm working now. I was in Kelowna, and then I'm going back to Kelowna now as well. Yeah, I've been actually a midwife for 5 years now. I kept thinking it was 3 years, 3 years, 3 years, and then I realized I've been saying 3 years for a long time. And then I did the math and realized I've been working for 5 years. So, time flies.
And And so there's some people who have a few comments. Kim Roan said, we don't have any midwives in Sioux Lookout, but there's interest at this time. She said it was very insightful, your presentation. L. Taylor says he has many questions, but I don't know if he's typed them in yet. L, if you want to type in some questions, you can do so. On video conference, is there anybody in Kispiox or Adams Lake or Gwishtin Health? Is that, do you, Gwishtin Health that you want to ask? You just have to unmute your microphone and then you can ask Evelyn any questions that you'd like. Adams Lake, do you have any questions for Evelyn? Okay. So we'll provide some of those links, resources, and videos if you go back to the original posting on the site, as well as we'll email everybody who was registered. Serena's question was just that if they can get a copy of the presentation. So you're going to be able to, we're able to share the PowerPoint too. Is that okay with people? We can load that up to our site and share. Evelyn, is that
sure.
Okay?
That's fine.
Yeah. Okay. Well, if that's it, I just want to thank again the people who helped make this webinar possible, which is First Nations Health Authority and the UBC, of course. And also Davina Ridley, who's here, who's the program assistant, and Catherine Barry. We also have Indigenous Health. We are actually officially part of the center now. Thanks, everyone. We'll see you soon. Hopefully see you tomorrow.